Welcome, everyone. The Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code of India is a very, very interesting legislation to study, to talk about its evolution in India, because it not only filled a very important gap in our regulations, especially for the financial sector, but also the way the jurisprudence is developed and the way our courts have upheld the key intent of the legislation, which was drafted based around similar to the UK laws rather than the US laws, keeping in mind the concept of a creditor in possession rather than a debtor in possession. I think the way that whole concept has developed, I think, is overall, to me, it seems been a very, very good progress. Of course, in India, whenever there is a new legislation, just given the volume of the kind of issues that can come up, both qualitatively and quantitatively, it's not going to be easy to navigate. And that's why today we have with us Som, who's actively worked on a lot of these issues, worked on IBBI, and is an expert in the field. And we thought it would be really helpful to understand, you know, where we think where it has gone already and where it is going in terms of the jurisprudence of this not so new anymore, but still relatively new legislation. Now, in its 3 years of its existence, the IBC has undergone substantial modifications, both through judicial pronouncements and legislative amendments. And most of the jurisprudence has developed in reaction to the industry's response to the court and the unique circumstances prevailing in certain sectors like infrastructure and real estate. And some trends have also emerged. I think I'll just outline a few key of them. One, we've seen that the big ticket cases take more time, not surprisingly, especially, you know, some of the big ones can have, you know, up to hundreds of parties involved, and so have not really followed the typical timeline provided. We've also seen that in recent years, the recovery rate has gone down. In fact, as per IBBI report itself, in the quarter ending December 2019, the recovery rate was just 12%, which is down from the previous quarters. And recovery rate is better when companies are going concerns rather than defunct companies. All of this really helps us understand, you know, where the key issues might be arising in the future and where both the courts and the legislature need to focus. And that's why we want to take the discussion today. So let me, on that note, just start with the most important question, right? This was the creditor in possession question. So how has the IBC worked out for the creditors? For the intention that it was intended in the first place in terms of recovery for the creditors?
Thanks for having me. It's interesting to have this conversation from a legislative history perspective of a law that's so young, but has been such a cat among the pigeons that it's been a hugely disruptive, in a nice way, influence over how the business of lending is done. So when we speak about creditors, I do think that this law has placed financial creditors on a far superior footing as compared to how they have handled, how they have faced circumstances historically. Has it been spectacular for non-financial creditors, like operational creditors? I think the real risk of, you know, not just investments being subject to market risk, businesses being subject to market risks has been brought to the fore. So if you look at some of the large resolutions that have happened recently, where the financial creditors took a large haircut, a number of operational creditors have also taken far bigger haircuts. And that was subject matter of one evolution of case law where the appellate tribunal rewrote the haircuts that different creditors are meant to take. And the Supreme Court reiterated that the courts can't substitute their wisdom for what the creditors come together and do under the framework of the law. So I would say that from a financial creditor's point of view, it's put them on a far better bargaining position. From an operational creditor's point of view, it's given them a weapon, which is essentially to be able to threaten that a moratorium could be pulled on. But it's a bit of a, can be a bit of a mug's game, because an operational creditor, after invoking the IBC, may go back without a seat at the table at the COC and stand in queue in the resolution plan and not actually get anything out of it. So it's a mixed bag on that count. But overall, it's put the risk of default, the consequence of default, at a far completely different footing as compared to what we're used to seeing historically over the decades.
So do you see this as more of for operational creditors and even for financial creditors to a large extent, something to bring like over the long term, right? Of course, we are still in the reactionary phase and still in the evolutionary phase. But is it something that you're seeing as you to be used more as bringing the company's promoters to the negotiation table, a way of evolving recovery rather than actual resolution process? Where do you see the cases going more forward, and what is your advice broadly to the creditors?
If you look at it purely from a game theory perspective, I do think that the era of being cynical about defaults is history. Like 3 years is a long time, however young the law may be. I think the risk of facing a default and the fear of the consequences of a default is extremely, extremely high today. And therefore, financial creditors are meant to be taken far more seriously thanks to this law. Operational creditors too, because of the sheer danger of one of them pulling the plug and invoking the IBC, are better off as compared to where they have been historically. And this is something we need to talk about when we look at more recent developments like the COVID situation. So I do think that the risk of not paying monies when due and the consequences of that is a significant one. And indeed, as you say, whether it would it bring people in management or in substantial ownership of the company to the table with the fear of bankruptcy proceedings being triggered? Yes, of course, that's been a big, big change. One other trend that's developed, unintended, but through judicial commentary, like more arbiter than ratio, is that there is an unstated, unlegislated presumption that revival is preferred over bankruptcy. Now, this has come through even in the commentary of the courts, but if you look at the legislation, there is no such preference that's been stated. Frankly, as this evolves, we may perhaps evolve into an era where a business that can't make two ends meet is meant to be bankrupted rather than revived, is the philosophy that will develop over time. It is going to be challenging. There have been other challenges, as you said, some reactionary amendments or constant amendments have followed. In a sense, these amendments found favor as being a means of ironing out crudities and inequities that have developed in these in the running of the law, which led to the legislation's constitutional validity being upheld. So I think even the courts are willing to give a longer rope and willing to see if these inequities would go away over time with more empirical evidence being available over time. And I would therefore say that from a creditor's perspective, the creditor, it's a very creditor-friendly legislation for sure.
Until you come to real estate. Sorry, Arjun, you had a question.
Yeah. Thanks, Pratibha. So, Soam, just coming to a different aspect on the impact of the insolvency code. We have seen that a lot of special situation funds and stressed asset funds are showing a lot of interest in the Indian secondary debt market. Do you think that this is a direct impact of the IBC and the fact that a lot of banks, even during the continuation of the process, prefer to sell off their exposure in a corporate debtor than to wait out for the process to get over? And do you think that this is just the beginning of a revitalized secondary debt market in India?
Yeah, I mean, from a secondary debt market as it's conventionally understood, like literally a throbbing securities market for debt securities is not what you're talking about. But a secondary market for indebtedness being traded per se, you're absolutely spot on. It's something that's really, really made a mark a lot more in recent times. There used to be a time when debt used to be traded in the fight for corporate control. I don't know if you remember during the Mallya Chhabria dispute or between the when the in the 80s and the 90s, takeovers were looked at. Industrialists would often buy debt and use the debt to push for liquidation and then take over control. And that used to be a fledgling small presence of activity in the market. But today, if you look at which way policy is headed and which way perhaps future legislative amendments will come in, there is an exploitation of the power of the vote at the COC table. That's got value. So just as there would be a value for equity voting power, the value of voting at a COC's meeting is something that can be capitalized on, is the complaint that you hear also. So in the conflict that happens in the ecosystem, I think what is definitely being recognized today is that it's profitable, it's reasonable, it's rational to price debt and buy debt. And for banks, it's very good news if they're able to offload assets and get liquidity out of debt that they do not want to hold and somebody else sees value because there's power to the voting power attached to the debt in the COC as a forum. You know, you're no longer looking at voting power of equity shares in a going concern situation. In these situations, you're looking at voting power attached to debt in the COC platform. And to that extent, that debt gets value. And anyone who sees value in the underlying business is going to price that debt. And that is bound to lead to a secondary market for debt. And we are seeing symptoms of that already. If you look at some of the, I can speak about matters which are over after disputes. If you look at the whole Binani cement dispute. I mean, the whole issue was around, is the process sacrosanct or is the substance sacrosanct? These were early days of the court. And in the process, what was in play was the power of the vote at the COC. And the power of the vote at the COC came to the fore and to see whether you're okay buying debt and saying, okay, I will pay your debt off. Now let me get the debt and I come into the COC and call for rebates literally. And if I could have done that, I could do that by simply paying the lenders off. So lenders, imagine lenders were sitting in the COC are saying, no, now you can't pay us. We have this COC vote, which is more important. We don't want to be paid in full. We have done a deal. We have struck a deal. We want to ensure this deal goes through. That tells you something about the economic implications of the power of this vote. Like one would normally think that if one pays the lender the last rupee due, the lender would be happy. But you do see situations where the lender says, the time to pay my debt is gone. You now have to deal with me as a man with power in the COC not just somebody who needs his money back. So these are symptoms of showing how the secondary market is going to have a lot of value for debt.
Which is bringing back some amount of semblance in terms of balance, which the Indian markets didn't have before, right? Like it was a pure promoter, pure equity game. So that's actually, to me, it's a very welcome move till, you know, everything shifts, you know, too much on the creditor side, which is a danger in the Indian market always. You know, we seem to go to extremes. Payal, you had a question.
I'm going to actually take a step back and move away a little bit from the secondary market and all of that. But as a pure disputes lawyer, I have seen that over the last 3 years, it has fairly developed through various series of judicial pronouncements. The law has evolved, and we have seen a sort of clients inclined to go ahead with the IBC route, actually. Even if there is a simple debt which is there, a creditor can take this route. But several options are available on the table. Now, the first one that matters is it something that you're using as a pressure tactic because you want to get the other side to the table for a negotiation? Or how would you approach it when there are several other options available? Would you still advise the creditor to go ahead with the IBC route?
So again, much will obviously, as you know, depend on the facts of each case and what the motivations are and what the insecurities of each side are. You know, it's a clash of insecurities that leads to strategic gaming in these situations. Having said that, if you're an operational creditor and you desire to use the IBC, obviously you can create enormous disruption. There's value that can be gained, as we've seen, from operational creditors, which even led to the law being amended to allow for settlements after the first situation develops, and for courts to take on record settlements between parties. That was actually a reaction and a symptom of the use of this platform for effective recovery. What is a settlement, after all, between a debtor and a creditor? But the terms of recovery and the terms on which the parties settle. So that is one truth. But equally, another truth is the power of the gun exists until the trigger's pulled. Like once the trigger's pulled, the victim may actually not exist or may be maimed, may not be in a position to actually engage in any meaningful manner. So really, as I said, depending on the facts of the situation, it can really be used as a tool, and it does get used a lot as a tool. Having said that, it's not a nuclear option, but it's a bit of a serious weapon. The utility of which can start diminishing, particularly for an operational creditor who may not have a say in the terms on which the game will play out after the process starts. Because remember, a lot of readjustment of rights and obligations happen in REM. It's no longer in personem. So when these differences happen in REM, i.e. against society at large, and equities are readjusted across society at large, it's going to be very, very difficult to roll any of that back. And to that extent, one's voice may be drowned out. Apart from the joy of pulling the trigger, one may not really get much. So even for financial creditors, depending on the scale of the debt involved in the overall balance sheet, one would have to think a lot more carefully before using this as a blunt weapon for recovery. It's of course a huge threat. It's of course a huge tool in the game of brinkmanship. But if a debtor is to have a lot more, so much debt that he doesn't worry about you, it won't give you much value.
Thanks, Om. Let me take you from here to a more sensitive topic for your general financial creditors, which is adding home buyers as a specific category of financial creditors. You know, that's something that's, of course, again, evolved under special circumstances of Indian real estate sector, where it was when IBC came out, and the consequences of these companies going into insolvency at a time where the home buyers had still not got possession, and still might not get possession, just, you know, based on the reality of some of these proceedings. In that context, how do you see this having played out of, you know, literally through a court process being forced to include home buyers in the process? Do you think it's something that's worked out well? Good intention, of course, but how do you see that playing out?
So I think it's a tricky one. This could either be a spectacular success a decade down the line, or it could have been a disastrous slippery slope a decade down the line. But sitting where we are today, 2 points I want to make. The whole concept of roti kapda makan in Indian society is very, very deeply entrenched. So therefore, a home which is bought by a largely poor society, I mean, we were, until about 25 years ago, a very poor country. We still are a very poor country, of course, with huge income and wealth inequality, which is literally two segments of society far removed, not recognizable to each other, but living in one republic. So in that, buying of a home is such a central, powerful event in a human's life that between roti kapda makan, the makan does become a very, very valuable, precious sort of concept in society. But if you now change tack and look at the industry, largely the industry financed itself primarily by borrowings from the home buyers, essentially advances, essentially installments. The home buyers were the ones providing working capital. The home buyers were the ones really providing financing to the industry. It does beg the question, are they not conceptually financial creditors too, in some element? Like, even today, if you were to sit in NCLAT and listen to some of the appeals that get argued, matter after matter, industry after industry, you will find disputes over classification of the creditor. Is he a financial creditor or is he an operational creditor? Is factoring financial credit or is factoring operational credit? People are raising issues in litigation over even obvious things like, say, bill discounting, which is very obviously perhaps a financial service and financial credit. But let's say a bill is not discounted, but a counterparty to a trade gives you a bill, draws a bill, and it's an accommodation bill. Would you call it financial credit or will you call it operational credit? So this dispute continues across industries, across the board. When you look at it from that prism, it's not illogical to think that if a counterparty is actually financing you substantially, he should be treated as a financial creditor. And particularly if you're going to put powers in the hands of a collective and you have a creditor elite which has the right to decide in rem, as I said, how obligations across society can be readjusted. Should these guys not have a seat at the table or a voice to be heard at the table is a question to ask. If you look at it from that philosophical, conceptual perspective, it's not such an oddity or an iniquity to let home buyers in. The question really is, how does one define the concept well enough for this to work across industries rather than just pick one industry and make that happen? So I think we need to look for some more empirics. We need to look for some more data on the home buyer credit front. What's actually transpired? What sort of resolutions happened? Did resolutions happen at all? The one other thing I want to say in this context is we as a society need to get rid of stigmatizing bankruptcy. That stigma still exists. That stigma has been embedded in the law in Section 29A. And unless that stigma goes away, it's going to be difficult even for the home buyers Because the funny part is the constituency is being addressed with a view to give specific performance for the home rather than saving their credit exposure. So there comes a dichotomy. And if on the quasi-judicial side, if one starts looking at specific performance or starts looking at how to give them houses instead of giving them maybe 80 paise in a rupee, we need to have that change in mindset as well to make this meaningful for the home buyers within the constructs of the IBC bunch of rights.
See, when you're talking to a US-trained lawyer, these concepts seem so alien to me. But when you put it in that context of the way you just put it as them funding, some of these projects, that drives home point a lot better. And I think that's why we need jurisprudential lawyers like you practicing in these matters, so you can help develop the jurisprudence accordingly rather than it being a jerk reaction to a specific problem. And I totally agree, we are involved in one of these home buyer matters where the court is more focused on building the project. And that's why it will take, I don't know how many years to resolve it, because it is not the court's job to get projects built. And that was never the purpose of, these laws. Having said that, I guess, we are where we are. And we'll just have to see how we ensure that then this doesn't dilute the definition of a financial creditor. Sorry, Arjun, you had a question.
Yeah, thanks, Pratibha. So, Som, there's a question on this aspect from the participants as well. And like you were just talking about categorization and classification of creditors. So on that aspect, we understand that there has been a recent amendment by which allottees of real estate projects, that's home buyers, as well as security holders and deposit holders have been put into a particular bracket, where although they are categorized as financial creditors, there is a threshold for them to trigger insolvency proceedings, which is of at least 100 members or 10% of the total number of members which form that group. So considering that the Supreme Court in the Pioneer Urban judgment has already dealt with these kind of contentions, where the petitioners had asked the court whether even if home buyers are considered to be financial creditors, there should be some kind of a threshold for them to trigger the process. And the Supreme Court had very categorically said that there are enough safeguards there for corporate debtors to not be prejudiced by applications being filed by individual home buyers. Why do you think this kind of an amendment specifically distinguishing certain classes of creditors and home buyers from other financial creditors makes its way into the code?
That's what I was alluding to in my earlier response on this subject, that I think picking one industry and writing a special law around it would be the wrong way to go, rather than pick the concept of funding coming from operational creditors to the extent it's a financial funding being treated as financial credit. But what does happen in legislative history as far as our republic is concerned is when you have a special law, it immediately leads to feedback and pushback and the felt need to sort of worry about have we gone too far, and therefore write a few more patches, to use a software phraseology. You release a version and then you start putting patches on it. So you feel, oh, now have we empowered every single home buyer? Anybody who has to get one flat, can it trigger? Okay, now can we write a check and balance on that? So you write a new version of it. How do you conceptualize that? You look at operation mismanagement jurisprudence. You say, okay, 100 members versus 10% of the voting power. Pick some concept from there, force fit that. That's how most legislation has evolved here. Sadly, if we get into too much of a knee-jerk patchwork sort of solution, legislative solutions, this can end up in a serious mess. So when I said that 5 to 10 years down the line, this could either be a huge success or a disaster. I would put the huge success scenario being the concept being understood so well that it's capable of being applied across industry. A disaster would be putting in place this quick fix, which is then not quick anymore because there are so many multiple fixes to it that it loses meaning and becomes unwieldy. And someday the whole baby gets thrown out with the bathwater and you say, you know, this is not work. We need new thinking. And in lawmaking, remember, there's always going to be pulls and pressures. There's always somebody or the other who's going to say that the situation is disastrous. So when home buyers say everything is disastrous, he write a piece of law. When the industry comes back and says the solution is disastrous, we write another bunches of provisions. And then we keep swinging. So it's bound to happen. So if I would like to wait a little more, get more empirical data on how this transpires, and then see what needs to be done with it.
And then there's more than what meets your eye, right? Like in a country like India, where you've got a whole parallel economy, especially in the real estate sector, where you might have paid up, you know, not necessarily all in check transaction, a lot of cash transactions have happened. And then you go into this process, the formal process doesn't recognize that money having been paid. So there's going to be, you know, in the Indian context, layers within layers, which you know, if you keep solving for each, as you said rightly, you're going to create a big, huge mess. Okay, let me on that note just go into the stigmatization that you talked about, which is encoded in 29A. You know, for the purposes of the listeners, 29A basically prevents certain people who are either defaulters of the corporate debtor or undesirable due to other incapacities that are mentioned in the section or are a related party even to another defaulting party. Then they're prevented from gaining control by basically they're declared ineligible under 29A of the IBC. So how do you look the 29A jurisprudence being developed and the effect that has on the bidding process, on how the whole structure as it was originally laid out in terms of getting some of the investors to come in and bid, getting affected through this process?
Saying 29A was actually a knee-jerk reaction. If you remember the way it got legislated, there was an ordinance and then became law, and labels were formed about some dirty dozen or some phraseology that had developed about how it is meant to deal only with some select cases. And but we're writing a law, we'll look at it later. The two problems essentially with 29A, most of the undesirability criteria in 29A are unexceptionable. You can, if somebody is guilty of evident fraud or is guilty of siphoning of funds or is guilty of willfully defaulting, sure, you don't want them around a resolution, because a resolution, remember, is a postponement of death. You actually sort of putting the patient on a ventilator in the hope that this patient is going to survive and you need not pull the plug. So who can the authors be? The disqualification in 29A, by and large, gets it right. Two problematic parts of it. The one about mere NPA, that to my mind was disastrous, because it is something which stigmatizes default. I mean, running a business, inherent to it is the risk of failure and the risk of being unable to pay debts when due. And if that were to happen, to say that you are ineligible to write a resolution plan for the very same business is still understandable. But in its terms, the way it was drafted before interpretation was, you can't author any resolution plan for any company in India. And the sting in the tail was the explanation with the extending it to related parties and connected parties. And when you look at that definition, that really, really made it problematic. I mean, technically, if you read it literally the way it is, before the Supreme Court gave a lot of guidance in both SR and Swiss ribbons on how to read 29A, it was a very problematic provision. It's less problematic after the court has elaborated and explained the court's reading of how 29A is to be read. But time was when any and every affiliate of any multinational would have been ineligible, because in other parts of the globe where bankruptcy is not stigmatized, some affiliate, some related party would have gone bankrupt or would have had an NPA, but that would have delegitimized their ability to write any resolution plan for any company in India. Now, if you look at it as an ineligibility to write a resolution plan for that company and that asset, it lessens the burden. But one interesting element, if you look at some of the two judgments, both Swiss Ribbons and ArcelorMittal and SR, where even the concept of control has been discussed, you know, for example, whether affirmative rights can constitute control or not, rights typically given to minorities to protect them on specific matters, can that become controlling power? Versus the power of a majority. We also have cases of majority having veto rights over everybody else. That's a separate story. But what is control? What sort of rights you can have? All of that is now a little better distilled. And therefore, we've come to live with a constitutionally valid, declared to be valid provision exists, which does also remind us that the court did say that inequities and oddities have historically, in this 3 years, in this 2.5 years history, when the judgment got written, have been ironed out. And we hope this will also, I mean, eventually, it's a judicial hope that after getting empirical data, some of these inequities will be ironed out. So I do think that 29A needs to be made more rational. I do think that when it is revised, when it is reviewed, it should not be linked to a mere NPA. I mean, frankly, if you look at even the COVID, you did discuss that you want to talk a bit about the COVID-related amendments, which we'll come to. But the aftermath of COVID-related disqualification in 29A is going to be a very complicated subject.
Mm.
Now, it's one thing to say that during lockdown or during this financial year, you're not going to use Section 7, 9, 10. But what about a long-term impact of what happens during lockdown, which leads to an NPA, and its impact on 29A, are we thinking about that? So these are questions that will come up. So 29A is constitutionally valid, but is it good law from an economics point of view? No, good law and good economics need not go hand in hand. A constitutionally valid good law can be poor economics also. So 29A falls in that bucket. It's under trial. And I think we have to wait to see, maybe in a year's time. I think post-COVID is a great time to look at what to do with this provision. And if the original verbal commentary that came from the lawmakers then is to be good, it's run its course. The first set of willful defaulting assets where those in control were found undesirable to come back into play, that's run its course. So maybe prospectively, leaving aside the undesirable elements of the undesirability elements, the good parts of 29A, so to say, it needs material amendment on these two facets.
Yeah, unfortunately, we make the laws for the minimum common denominator, right? That's the problem sometimes, because our enforcement is flawed. So then we prevent pretty much business by law as a result. And 29A is a good example of that, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But in the interest of time, because there are many questions, let's move to the recent amendment. Pal, you want to take that up?
Actually, I think a similar question has already been posted, as you mentioned. I mean, what I wanted to discuss is with this blanket immunity, which has been granted in the recent amendment, how do you see spanning out, whether it's going to actually serve its purpose, the reason behind its amendment? And actually, on the contrary, the question which has been posed is, do you see that to be actually being misused rather than actually serving the purpose it's intended to serve?
Yeah, actually, Payal, I have a slightly different view. I mean, this word immunity is a good label. It's a sticky label. It sticks well. But let's remember, it's also a disability. There are three entry points to IBC. One is from an operational creditor, one is from the financial creditor, and a very important one from the corporate debtor himself. Now, I don't understand why we should stop the corporate debtor from knocking the doors and saying, hey, I need the protection of a moratorium, because I believe with a moratorium over the next several months, we should be able to turn this company around. I want to bring you guys to the table to have a conversation. So I think not distinguishing between 7 and 9 on the one hand and Section 10 on the other is a very, very problematic intervention. So, for example, let's take MSMEs, like small and medium scale enterprises. Now, many of them, when you bump up the threshold for accessing the IBC, many of them would have dues from larger businesses, which may be lower than the threshold with which you can knock the doors of IBC. Now, during COVID, of course, those bigger businesses will have immunity. The smaller businesses anyway can't go in and knock the doors. But when these smaller businesses may want to restructure themselves and they want to knock the door under Section 10, that's not going to be available to them. So it's a problem area. I think blanket suspension of Section 10 is an error that needs to be rectified. I think if the ordinance were to be re-promulgated, this needs some attention, because we do need to remove this crudity, because it's really a blunt weapon to just say we cut off all doors, because one is not a door, one is an exit, one is not an entrance, one is an exit. So if businesses feel the need for a moratorium to give themselves a breather, even that is not available today. So that is one area to think about. Likewise, if you think about what happens after the time frame given for this, it's going to be again a question of what is the economic impact of what happened now. Of course, we have a very evidently empirical ability to decide whether it's a default that occurred one day before the line or one day after the line. But imagine a company which struggled and made ends meet before the line, but is now defaulting and wants a moratorium. We are happy to tell them, look, nobody can take you to the IBC. So no, there'll be no moratorium, stay happy. But if the person says, but look, I want to negotiate and I want a turnaround, we say, no, sorry, even that is not going to be available. So that is a problem we need to think about when this ordinance comes up for re-promulgation. Because I don't know if Parliament will be in session, given the state of how things are.
Before Arjun steps in, I just had a follow-up on this. Even before how Parliament is going to react, considering how the judiciary has reacted so far when it comes to the entire series of rulings and IBC-related issues, do you think, how will the judiciary approach this and look at this particular issue when it comes to this aspect? Because, I mean, it has been a bumpy ride when it comes to several set of rulings from various NCLTs coming in, and you actually end up for an NCLAT or a Supreme Court decision to come in. How do you think the judiciary is going to look at this?
I think, to be fair, COVID is unprecedented. Nobody expected to deal with something so extraordinary, with a population so humongous. And we're seeing it play out as we speak, like what can be allowed, what can't be allowed. It's everybody's learning. But from a IBC perspective, the impact of COVID, I would have thought, but for this intervention, the courts would have not hesitated to make the provisions run their course. If there was an approach from a financial creditor, if all the boxes are checked, you'd pass an order for a moratorium. And that is why the amendment was actually made to empower the courts to be able to move away from what the law was. And that's why the amendment was very, very necessary. But going forward, in terms of if someone were to challenge the constitutional validity of this amendment, I think that's a long one. It's a tricky one, because if it's genuinely as temporary as it has been promised to be, the problem may solve itself. You may not want to rule in a vacuum for a question that's become academic. But let's say this continues over the next two financial years and a constitutional challenge were to come. I think these are the areas where an Article 14 classification issue will arise. What happens to a person who genuinely had a legitimate expectation of being able to approach the IBC to restructure himself as a debtor? You've taken that right away when actually the need for that becomes higher. Is that arbitrary? Is that not arbitrary? It begs the question. This will be subject matter of the debate. What happens to a person who's made all ends meet before and defaults after, or makes all ends meet even during, but post-COVID, post-lockdown, in the next financial year, there is a delayed impact on him and the economics of it plays out where he defaults? Now, do we throw him under the bus despite having been diligent in paying? These are questions that will come up in a constitutional challenge. It's very, very difficult to look at a crystal ball and say which proposition would hold good one way or the other. A lot of facts of those with locus will also come into play in terms of setting the tone of the discourse in that challenge. So it is an interesting area to think about. I do feel that the single biggest classification problem is not distinguishing between the creditor approaching the IBC and the debtor approaching the IBC. The debtor's capacity to approach the IBC should not have been lightly taken away, in my
and view. That was actually criticized even before they came out with the final resolution on this, but somehow was not taken into account. Arjun, you have a question, and then we should really jump into the Q&A.
Yeah, Pratibha. So quickly, I'm going to a different aspect, which is the impact of the IBC on listed entities. So in 2018, SEBI had released a discussion paper in which it had specifically asked for comments from the public on whether there should be a temporary suspension on trading of securities for a listed company undergoing IBC. After that, we have had amendments to LODR, delisting, takeover code, all of that. But there hasn't been any talk about this aspect. So do you think there should be any tweaks made to the listing standards which currently are there, so that when a company undergoes IBC proceedings, it automatically falls foul of that? Or whether there should be some kind of blanket suspension of trading once IBC proceedings start?
Yeah, this is a tricky one. Economics professors who look at secondary markets fall into completely different camps. Some believe that markets are all about pricing on an informed basis. So merely because a company is insolvent, price discovery for its securities shouldn't stop. There's another school of thought which believes that the market is for businesses that are going concerns, and informed pricing can only happen when the enterprise is a going concern. If the enterprise itself is under IBC or is under resolution or it can't pay its debts, it becomes very difficult to price it. So it becomes a bit of a casino and a punt. It's impossible. The point about an informed pricing decision is a mirage, is the other view. Now, willy-nilly, we've historically, if you looked at Indian secondary market history, our society has never suspended trading. I don't know if you remember how old some of you are, some of you are millennials, but when I was young, there used to be a company called Metal Box. So when I went to college, we used to see metal box used to be traded. Metal box was perpetually under BIFR. For decades, it was under BIFR. And it was perpetually on the stock market, because as students, when we used to try and think of what stocks as students we should look at, we would look at things that were priced at 1 rupee and 50 paise, and metal box used to come there. And that's why one learned that metal box is perpetually under BIFR. So the question is not about whether listing and trading should continue, because we seem as a society to have a long legacy of letting trading continue. If we accept that as a given, how do we make that most efficient? How do we make that least inefficient? Who is to be responsible for timely and accurate dissemination of information about that enterprise when the moratorium is on and when the resolution is on? So if you suppose there is a fire in the factory of a company which is under IBC. Now, within 15 minutes, you're supposed to say to the stock exchange. Now, how do you say it? Who's responsible if it's not said? Is it the RP? Is it the board? Is the board's power supersession of the board's power, meaning that the board only loses its power but not its obligations? These are questions that could be thought about. With, of course, you can say the compliance officer and the securities law. You say the compliance officer is responsible, and the compliance officer should brief the RP so that and the COC, which is a super board, on special matters. Now, frankly, one way to look at this is to look at the IBC as a legislative M&A framework. Frankly, what is the IBC but a legislative codified M&A legislation? It's meant for special situations M&A. Then how do you do M&A activity when the company is not necessarily a going concern, when it is insolvent, not yet bankrupt? Or how do we declare it to be bankrupt and then do M&A with individual undertakings or whatever can be sold? So if you look at it purely from an M&A perspective, and then look at it from an arbitrage of information between those in the M&A deal room and those in the secondary market, how do we bridge that in the normal course? In the takeover regulations, you have protections for material events that can't be done without going back to the general body. In the LODR regulations, you have provisions to say that any restructuring on the M&A side, when certain thresholds are met, must be immediately notified to the stock exchange. We have to wear that same hat and pin down a certain crystallized nature of responsibility, of determination of timing of disclosure and responsibility for disclosure. And we may be able to solve that problem. And a little more informed decision making can take place. Having said that, no matter what we do, the kind of inside information, the kind of data that the COC would see, you know, what sort of Chinese walls can you keep? What sort of trading restrictions can you keep on those supporting the COC? Is there insider trading possible if the stock is trading with such volatility possibility? These are subject matter of future securities, jurisprudence and litigation that will develop. Because frankly, to let a company whose health is like literally on a ventilator and on a yo-yo, for its shares to be traded, someone somewhere is going to get hurt and going to complain. And then depending on the size of the constituency, the political pressure for a social legislative reaction will come in, and then some law may get written. But pending that, if we want non-solvent companies to be traded, we have to live with this danger.
Seems to be at least some pattern there in terms of reactive legislations. Can I just, I really want to hear your view on group insolvencies before we go on to Q&A. So, you know, do you see a need for something to be done there?
Group insolvency is actually a very, very tough subject. It's very, very difficult. I mean, if you look at large situations like ILFS, where any of you trying to enter the courtroom couldn't do because it was jam-packed. And when case law developed with assigning green, red, amber colors to companies to see what is capable of being turned around and what's not. And remember, that was not even under the IBC. That was under Section 241, 244, oppression, mismanagement, jurisprudence, but let's leave that aside. I think group level insolvency policy is under active consideration. There is a UK SINA working group that has worked on it and given a report. That is under active consideration. I'm part of a cross-border insolvency group, which is also looking at group insolvency. Group insolvency becomes even more sensitive when you look at cross-border implications. For example, if you remember the Lehman crisis, Lehman Brothers had two entities in India. And the RBI used exchange control powers to say that those entities will have a moratorium on honoring their obligations to any external parties. The idea was to conserve whatever capital Lehman solvent entities had in India and ring-fence that from the liquidator of Lehman outside India. So there's a lot of work that would actively be done. I'd encourage the UK SINA committee report to be read. That should be available publicly. But I think it's enormous work in progress. Until that comes in, we will need these completely unscientific, out of the ordinary, non-precedent setting solutions like using oppression mismanagement framework for moratoriums like we see in ILFS.
Understood. At least we know where to send our comments to. Okay, so quickly jumping into the questions. First question we have is, if a resolution applicant wants to give a plan after a plan is approved by the COC and the new deal is of a much higher value, what is your, whether the new applicant should be entertained or not?
I think this is now water under the bridge. This was this came up in the Binani situation. And I think really the question was, is the process integrity more important, or is higher and full recovery more important? And if I'm not mistaken, now this is legislatively solved for as to at what point in time the process becomes sacrosanct and becomes inexorable. I think again, this we have to understand this concept of the in rem implications of an IBC process. When we run an IBC process, when the COC sits there, it invites bids, it asks everyone to come in, and there is a degree of competitive, participative capacity that's available. And if people then come in with a slightly better value, you can't be saying I'll entertain that. But I still think the jury may be out in determining what if someone comes and says, I'll pay every rupee of debt that's due out. That is something to think about. I mean, that then takes away the very substratum. But even there, if an entire process has been run after, and I think this has been solved for after that situation. So I do feel that now where we are in the evolution of this law, the process sanctity has become very, very important, particularly because the implications of a resolution plan affect societies across, members of society across the board. Frankly, I missed one point in Arjun's earlier question, the point about delisting, right? When he said that delisting was amended. Frankly, even an amendment to delisting was not necessary, because if you remember, the delisting regulations never applied to a scheme under SICA. And under the General Clauses Act, SICA was replaced by IBC, and the BIFR plan stood replaced by the resolution plan. And under Section 8 of the General Clauses Act, no amendment was even necessary, because the successor legislation sits in the place of the repealed legislation as a matter of law. So the implications of a resolution plan are far-reaching and affect entire unseen and unenvisaged, or people that is not, it's not so evident that they are affected by it. So then the process integrity becomes very, very important. So once the COC approves a plan, if you look at case law that's developed, increasingly the sovereignty of the COC has been upheld. Once the COC takes a final view, it's pretty much for the COC to decide. Like if the COC believes that a company can't be turned around, then courts have said you have to let the company go into the next stage, which is the COC's prerogative. So I think this will develop more towards keeping the process integrity intact and the COC having the last word. Once it's gone off the COC's table, it should not be possible to have a second bite at the cherry when it comes up for approval before the tribunal today.
Thanks. Related question is to elaborate on the concept of NREM under IBC and pre-IBC context.
Yeah, I saw that, Pratibha, which is why I spoke a bit about that in my earlier.
Yeah. I'm glancing through the questions.
Okay. No, I have nothing more to add. Essentially, for the non-lawyers that in the room, NREM means against the world at large, implications against society at large, whereas in personam would mean specific to the person concerned. So in an IBC situation, it's not a recovery suit in that. That's the reason it's not just between the creditor and the borrower. It's between what happens between the creditor and the debtor has implications for everybody who's doing business with the debtor. And that is the NREM impact of what happens when a bankruptcy situation emerges. Pretty much the reason why, on first principles in contract law, an insolvent is ineligible to contract. Or in every legislation, an insolvent is ineligible to hold office. If you look at disqualification for holding office, nobody reads these provisions every day. Like if you see disqualifications for, say, even the head of a regulatory organization, you'll find that he's not adjudged insolvent. Once you're insolvent, you're not in a position of balance to do the right thing in your job because you can't be allowed to touch society and inflict your touch on society. It's an ostracizing of the insolvent from the commercial world. And therefore that NREM concept of IBC, it's not just a recovery platform at all. It's a legislation whose footprint runs over a large segment of society. I think, Pratibha, there are a bunch of questions on 10A. Maybe we should
That's where I was going
to paraphrase and talk about 10A.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead?
So one is about 10A provides that no application filed for a period of 6 months extendable to 1 year. However, the proviso provides no application shall ever be filed for CRP for any default occurring. Sorry. There is an incomplete question.
I thought I was not able to read the full thing.
Yeah, but I suppose basically the question is about what happens after that 1 year. Is that the question?
Yeah, I think there was also a comment that there is a provision in law that even for something that happens within the time period, you can't take action.
No, the question really is if there's a default, the principle is there's a default in that period. Section 7, 9 and 10 stand suspended. That default can't be the basis of knocking the doors. So if the default has occurred during this period, you can never ever use this default for walking up to the IBC.
Yeah.
So, Pratibha, just to ask Som a question from the entire bunch. So, Som, there's a question on prepacks, and there has been some chatter before the introduction of the COVID-19 amendment that maybe the government is looking at some kind of one-time restructuring scheme or a prepack scheme like US, where we will give a breather for companies who are severely stressed because of COVID-19. Do you think that's something like that is feasible in the industry?
I think so. I think that is why the power of Section 10 should have been augmented, in my view. If you look at, say, the UK's response to COVID, or you look at other jurisdictions' response to COVID, they have not suspended their bankruptcy laws access. what they have done is modified their provisions for it. So one way to allow for this pre-pack would have been to create a framework using the fount of Section 10, which again gives you a little bit of an in rem impact of, you know, the world at large having a say, because you're doing it under the umbrella of IBC in front of the adjudicating authority. So a modified approach to resolution at the instance of the debtor is something that should have been thought through, perhaps even at the instance of the creditor. But we are in a social situation where NPA is, you know, what it is, and the banking industry, if it doesn't use or if it uses the prepack situation, may have vigilance inquiries there. Those are other social conditions. But at least the ability to walk up with a pre-negotiated resolution under Section 10 is something I would have liked to see. It's time for it. I totally agree. This is time for it.
Thank you. We are 10 minutes over time already.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to take one last question, which I think is very interesting in terms of the dual uncertainties implicit in the sale of corporate data as a going concern. Do you foresee there being any takers for this as an option in liquidation?
Takers for what?
For this as an option in liquidation.
Oh, sorry, Priva, I didn't get the first part.
So basically, the fact that, you know, even if you're taking the entity as a going concern, what are you inheriting is not very clear, nor has it been made very clear by the courts. In light of that, do you see people taking up these entities in liquidation?
So I think this is part of the transition, and we keep saying 3 year and transition. How the rest of the state agencies react and how the others come to terms with the changed reality in IBC is what will drive it. I was flummoxed to see that after resolution, a company which has been resolved was being acted against, with those newly in ownership also being acted against.
Yeah.
Those newly in management being acted against for past violations. I mean, these are, we have courts for that. They are the check and balance, and courts will set these right. But we shouldn't be burdening our courts with what should be obviously wrong things to do. And therefore, from the enforcement side, these are the things to avoid and not burden our courts with taking up such actions. Now, the jury is out. There's a huge debate still about the interplay between PMLA and IBC. So what if properties attached under PMLA are part of the estate that is being resolved and you're taking that out now? Will that continue to be attached, or is it a bit of a Ganga Snan that it comes out clean with new purity and life goes on as a going concern? To my mind, no framework for resolution will work if any of this past baggage continues. The whole point in a resolution is that this past baggage should come to an end, either by law, and if it is by law, with the check and balance of a full public hearing, anybody who wants to object can come and object. The PMLA guys can come there and object. The ED guys can come there and object. And then once the court rules, be bound by it and get on with saying this is not within our remit. Now, it's very, very important to have this finality. If we don't, then it's pretty much saying that the past baggage is so problematic that liquidation is the only option. And nobody gets anything anyway. And therefore, the company can't be resolved. So to my mind, a resolution is a completely binary thing. You either get it completely clean. The whole point in resolution is you write a new book, you start on a clean slate. What was a 10 rupee obligation is written as a 5. You start your balance sheet with a 5 on the liability side. So unless that certainty is there, this would be a complete waste of time. We can all feel good about specific cases and specific resolutions where nothing goes wrong, but if these problems can emerge, they can disrupt every single resolution plan going forward.
And in a way, this is the core essence of IBC process, right? If you can't come out of it owning a company clean, then especially in the Indian context, you just don't know what you might inherit. I mean, tax is the other major aspect of it.
Yeah, that's in fact one of the other reasons of the sheer uncertainty. The uncertainty that exists even now. I still think we have not tapped our full potential for sources of capital for resolving. The kind of capital that can come into resolution plans has not been tapped at all. You don't have vulture funds, you don't have distress funds, you don't have private equity playing the role that they are capable of playing. You largely have strategics, you have competitors, you have others in the industry, or you have people who want to diversify upwards or downwards with integration showing interest. But the full potential of unleashing and attracting all the sources of capital possible has not yet been achieved.
So having advised a lot of private equity players on this, I can tell you, I mean, initially it was, of course, also the fact that the strategics were bidding much more vigorously than the financial investors. But over time, the uncertainty of how the courts can go about it also weighs significantly on the financial investors, because they need to get in and get out timely, right?
I want to make just one other comment came to mind just as you were speaking, Pradeepa. If you, a very interesting case study is to look at what happened with AIG in the US. Okay. So when the crisis happened a decade ago and it was resolved with public money being used to bail it out, the shareholders were, their stakes were brought down and they were literally, it was an expropriation. And you know where that litigation went. They went on to say that now that the company is doing well, we as equity owners should get recompensed. And I don't know what's the current state of that litigation, but a court of appeal found some merit in that argument. So every society has its approach towards disenfranchising an owner. And ours will take a little more time to disenfranchise the promoter to become an acceptable one. If the US, with the way AIG was bailed out, could still have litigation about recompense after AIG is bailed out with public money, you shouldn't be surprised to see the litigation in India where promoters feel dispossessed because a creditor came and formed a COC and took the asset away. So this will evolve. It's a question of taking time to mature and evolve. For example, one benefit of 29A, because of this feeling of dispossession, was people who wanted to make themselves eligible paying the full debts due to every affiliate to ensure there's no related party who's an NPA. So this is still early days. I think we should wait 2 more years to collect full data to revisit the journey of this legislation.
My sense is, you know, Indian courts and legislature is less forgiving than the US. But you're right. Let's see. It all depends on, you know, which kind of promoter comes and claims for this. Very, very exciting and deeply involving discussion. I think we can go on for another half an hour, but I'm being reminded that I'm significantly over time already. But thank you so much, Som. It's great to hear insights of somebody who's practicing and helping write the legislation, legislative amendments. I think it's very helpful for people to understand what the thought process really is on the ground. On that note, I'm going to let you go and hopefully get you back for more discussion on these topics.